we are a bit delayed, but I still would like to very shortly introduce our speaker, even if those of us who are from CTP know Agnieszka, but not everybody who connects is from CTP. So Professor AgnieszkaJaniuk started her adventure with science, let's say, first at University of Warsaw and then at Nicolaus Copernicus Center, where she received her PhD. Then she was a postdoc, in particular at Max Planck Institute in Munich and University of Nevada, Las Vegas. She works at CTP since 2010, and since 2011 she was associate professor, but recently she was promoted to the full professorship, so she now holds this this title of full professor. And today she will be speaking about accretion onto black hole in collapsing stars. So please, Agnieszka.
So it is about accretion onto black hole in collapsing stars. The black hole concept is familiar to all of you, I think, here. But just to give the introduction and to give a tribute to the last year Nobel Prize in Physics, it was actually given to three people for different kind of research on the black holes. Among them, Roger Penrose was the author of the space-time singularity theorem. He proved that black hole is the final stage for gravitational collapse process, and it is inevitable if a trapped surface has formed in the space-time. He also discovered the process of extracting energy from a black hole at the expense of its momentum. We are talking here about rotating black holes. The first solution actually was found by Schwarzschild for a non-rotating black hole, but then situations which we are familiar with usually invoke rotation. So also the black hole may rotate, and they do rotate, and the black holes that rotate are described by the Kerr geometry. Here the metric element is given by such a formula where M, capital M, denotes the gravitating mass, the mass of this black hole. A, small a, is a dimensionless spin, so angular momentum per unit mass. The convention used here takes G equals C equals 1. The black hole are hidden behind the event horizon, and the horizon radius depends also on the spin parameter in the Kerr geometry. The black holes that are solutions of the field equations are mathematical structures, but we do observe, and we are familiar with many types of black holes in the universe. Different ranges of masses are found in cosmic objects. The stellar mass black holes are massive in the scale of the solar mass, or a few tenths of a solar mass, and they reside in transient and persistent systems. These sources are sources of X-ray emission, and we observe them through the X-ray satellite observations. Of course, we do not observe the black hole themselves, but we observe the gas that is falling down and captured by the gravitational potential of these black holes. And we observe the light emitted from the matter that is heated up to the millions or tens of millions of kelvins and emits this X-ray light. Typically, this matter has a structure of an accretion disk. So the matter also is concentrated in the equatorial plane of such a binary system, where the donor star is transferring mass to the compact star, the black hole. And in the equatorial plane, in the orbital plane, the accretion disk is formed. The black holes are born in the stellar evolution as the end products of the massive star evolution, and the newly born black holes are the engines of gamma ray bursts. These gamma ray bursts are transient events that happen at our gamma ray sky. They are very short and very energetic. I will tell you about these gamma ray bursts in a few slides more. But just to mention for completeness here, we also know that in the universe, the supermassive black holes reside in the centers of galaxies. Yes, here is the evolution sketch of the evolution of the star, where the black hole may be formed as the end product of the stellar evolution. Here in the bottom right part of this figure, you can see the black hole here. Other types of stellar remnants, of the compact remnants, are the neutron stars and white dwarfs. They are supported by the pressure of degenerate electrons in the case of white dwarfs, or degenerate neutrons. But in the case of black hole, this pressure is not sufficient to support against gravity, and the core collapses and forms a black hole. These black holes are formed, as I said, as the end product of a stellar evolution, which depends on the history of the star and on its mass mainly, because the black hole may be formed only from the stars of the highest mass. The initial mass of a star is called the main sequence mass, where the star is on the main sequence. It burns hydrogen, and in the fusion of hydrogen into helium, it can stay in this main sequence for many millions of years. But then it evolves through the supergiant phase, explodes as a supernova, and in the end, this compact remnant is left. The stellar evolution, as sketched in the previous slide, is not observed via the life of a single star, of course, because it is a very long process. So how do we know about the stellar evolution? Astronomers are observing numerous stars at various points in their lifetime, and then they can actually construct the sequences of the observed stars with different masses estimated, their luminosities measured, in different energy bands, in optical band mainly. Simultaneously, astronomers, astrophysicists are simulating stellar structure using computer models. And the equations of stellar structure are set of the ordinary differential equations, and they define a classic two-point boundary value problem. Here we have to compute the density in the star, the pressure in the star as a function of the radius, and total mass enclosed in the radius, and the temperature profile. And this type of stellar structure equations and the methods for solving them are known from the 1960s. Where this first attempts were made to solve the stellar structure equations with the shooting methods. But now, of course, we go much farther from with this. For instance, to compute the structure of the star and stellar evolution after the main sequence, we have to go beyond the hydrostatic equilibrium, modify it with some acceleration terms when the composition changes are very rapid. So the star actually exhausted its hydrogen fuel, different shells of heavier elements are formed, and the core structure is modified. Also, unstable burning adds entropy terms to the energy equation. But this is a long way to compute the stellar evolution until this pre-supernova explosion stages. Here you see the plot taken from the textbook by Thomas Janka, 2007, which shows the evolutionary stages from stellar core collapse through the onset of the supernova explosion to the neutrino cooling phase of the proton-neutron star. So, as you see here in the left upper panel, initial phase of the collapse starts. This is at the initial time of this simulation or of this process. Here you have the iron nitrogen formed already in the core of the star. This core is cooled by neutrino emission. Then you see the silicon shell outside this core. The bounce and shock formation is next. There is several sequences of several shocks bouncing up and down from the core. And finally, the proto-neutron stars is formed inside this core. The proto-neutron star mass is about 1.4 solar mass. If the remnant would be heavier than that, then 1.4 is this classical Chandrasekhar limit, or actually different ideas about the maximum mass of the neutron star are proposed, but still it cannot be more massive than two solar masses for any of the equations of state involved. We would have the black hole inside. After the core collapse of the supernova, the nature of the compact remnant mostly depends on the mass of the progenitor, on the main sequence, and also on some more details like the initial metallicity of the star, for instance. If it is much less than the solar metallicity, it is probably more likely to find a black hole as the compact remnant. On the other hand, massive stars heavier than 10 solar masses are frequently born in binary systems. Actually, about 70% of stars in the universe are in binary or hierarchical systems. It is quite rare to find a single massive star. So evolution here is a more complex process. It is driven by mass transfer also from the companion and includes some unstable episodes of the common envelope. The example here of an object that is quite mysterious is the Cassiopeia A supernova remnant. People observe here this supernova remnant in the constellation of Cassiopeia. And inferring from the expansion velocity of these shells, we can guess that the supernova explosion happened in something like 1700 or 1680 or 1650. But actually no information about new supernova was found in the historical archives. This supernova must be somehow hidden. It is supposed that the supernova in Cassiopeia I actually was the second supernova that happened in the system, which originally consisted of two stars. They were a white binary initially. Here the scenario is proposed from SATO 2020. Then the first supernova explosion happened. We don't know when. And the ejecta of this supernova interacted with the companion star. The plenty of this ejecta actually might be there to absorb the light emitted by the second supernova. And moreover, this second supernova had the envelope stripped apart. So it might be a dim object. But now the supernova remnant, which we observed, suggests that there was a supernova in the system. Okay, now about black holes. How we measure the masses and spins of black holes, which we know. We already have this black hole. How we can determine its spin and mass? And first of all, we observe the accretion process, as I shown you in one of the initial slides. The accretion onto black hole proceeds via the accretion disk. So we observe the light from this disk. As you know from the first slide, the inner the horizon radius and the innermost stable orbit radius depends on the spin of the black hole. So actually from observations of the accretion disk light, observations of both the continuum light and the emission lines, we can determine what is the innermost radius of the accretion disk. And hence, we can estimate the spin of the black hole, which depends, which affects this radius. For the mass of the black hole, it is actually possible from the Kepler laws, because we observe binary systems. So accretion disk is hiding the black hole. The black hole is invisible, but still the two stars, the black hole and the visible star, orbit around their common center of mass. And from the Kepler's law, from the orbital period, we can determine the so-called mass function and estimate the mass of the hidden, invisible companion, the black hole, when we know or estimate the mass of the visible star. The masses of more heavier black holes and those who are not visible through the X-ray observations can be determined now, I mean, since 5 years, through the gravitational wave observations. The gravitational waves are produced when accelerating masses generate changes in the space-time, and these changes, these waves propagate outwards with the speed of light. The observer will find the space-time distorted also here on the ground, so with the ground-based interferometers. The LIGO and Virgo are the currently used ones that measure the gravitational waves. And here you see the sketch of the process, the in-spiral of two massive bodies, the two black holes, the merger that is producing the peak of the amplitude in the gravitational wave, and then the single black hole formed at the end of this process. And the end of the gravitational wave signal. The Nobel Prize in Physics was given for that discoveries to three people in 2017. So to sum up the problem of masses and spins of the black hole, we have now the assembly of the LIGO-detected, Virgo-detected black holes and of this electromagnetically detected black holes, the X-rays emitting systems. What you see here is the assembly of masses of the known black holes, where typically the electromagnetically detected black holes have masses between 5 and 20 solar mass, 20 something, while the LIGO detected black holes are systematically more massive. They are as massive as 20 or 80 solar mass even, especially for the merger products, because the tree here shows the merger components with two smaller rings and the merger product with the bigger one. So both of these quantities, properties of the black holes, masses and spins here with LIGO are measured from gravitational waveforms. For the spins of the black holes, it is actually quite tricky because, as I said, in the electromagnetically found black holes, they can be estimated from X-rays and the measurements between the continuum fitting and the reflection or emission line measurements give consistent numbers between 0.304, the dimensionless spin of most of the systems, up to 0.95 for the most rapidly spinning black holes in the microquasars. And for the spins of the LIGO black holes, it is actually not possible to determine a single value of the spin. The data seem to disfavor large spins. In most of the systems, the spins are constrained to smaller than 0.4. But what we measure, it has to be stressed that what we measure is the actually mass-weighted projection of the spin vector on the orbital on the orbital angular momentum. So what we can have is only the probability distribution of the spins of the primary and secondary components. And for instance, here, for this source, you see the highest probability of measurement of the spin around of 0.5 for one of the components. Okay. Whatever the process is of this black hole formation, the most massive ones must have been formed also from the stellar collapse. And sometimes the gamma ray burst event is observed together with the stellar collapse, but not always. What are the conditions for that? Actually, there must be a rapid spin of the black hole, because from what we know, the rotational energy of the black hole might be somehow extracted and transformed into other types of energy, for instance, to accelerate the jets that are producing gamma rays. Gamma rays are produced when the jet breaks out from the collapsing stellar envelope. So it has to have really very huge power to break out from this envelope. The very massive star must have removed its outer envelope already before the jet launching. So that might happen in the binary interaction or through the stellar wind. And in the end, we have to have the black hole accretion disk structure that is launching the jet inside the collapsing envelope. Are the gamma ray bursts telling us something about their engine? Well, only indirectly, because what we observe here is the actually gamma ray burst is the signal in gamma rays. Between in the range of kilo or mega electronovolts, we detect these signals through the satellite observations. But what we observe is the count rate as a function of time. So you see here two types of the gamma ray bursts, the short and long ones. And these gamma ray bursts are variable. Short and long are really variable sources of gamma ray emission. So from this variability, we can infer some information about their progenitors. Also from the spectral energy distributions and from the total energetics of this event. So as I said, all gamma ray bursts probably are originating from the collapsing stars, at least all the long gamma ray bursts. I will not mention here the short gamma ray bursts, which might have different progenitors. But for the long gamma ray bursts, the statistic is such that observed duration of a gamma ray burst, which should be the difference between the time for which its central engine operates, the time of accretion, and producing the jet, and the jet's breakout time. So this was about the introduction, and I still hope that I have some time to present some works of our group. Actually, if I don't manage to present everything, I will invite you for next time to give another seminar. But I prepared for today selected projects of the CFT Astrophysics Group that are here done for several years with various students in my group. I will not list all of them. Here I listed three of them: stellar collapse without a bright transient, collapsars, the changes of black hole spin and mass, and the accretion in GRB engines and jet variability properties. So let me start with the first project, because yes, what I said just at the end of this introduction is that all gamma ray bursts, long ones, most probably result from the collapses of massive rotating stars. But on the other hand, do all massive collapsing stars produce gamma ray bursts? This is not the same. Yes, this is not the same. And actually, we can have direct collapse and formation of a black hole without a luminous transient. For instance, there are two stars that have been argued to disappear, two massive stars, yes, with these strange names. And they were found to disappear without an accompanying bright transient. So the stars were found in the data in the beginning of 21st century, observed with telescopes. This is the first observation in the V-band on July 2008, and the last observation on November 2014 of one of these stars, the N6946BH1, the name of this star is like that. But then the candidate was not found again in any of the telescope observations. The candidate is clearly detected in the first epoch, experience an outburst, and is not visible after 2009. So it's been already more than 10 years when this bright star disappeared. And there is another candidate like that of the name PHL LBV. LBV is the luminous blue variable. So this was the type of the star when it was visible, but then it disappeared. So how the star can disappear? We wanted to simulate this process in a simple way, actually, but we are using the tool for collapsing of the cloud, yes, in the general relativity. We use the code named HARM, High Accuracy Relativistic MHD Code, which solves the continuity and energy momentum conservation equations. And in general, the energy tensor can contain the gas and electromagnetic parts. But if we don't want to consider magnetized flow, we can limit ourselves to the gaseous cloud. So here are in tensor form the basic equations that code is solved, the continuity and the energy equation and the induction equation, and the components of the stress tensor, the gas and electromagnetic components. U here, U mu, U nu is the four velocities, U without an index is the internal energy, and the internal energy here is related with the pressure in the flow, in the simple way for the polytropic law. So gamma here is the index of the polytrope, and we take a constant number like 4/3. So what we want to describe is the collapse of the spherical cloud, or slowly rotating spherical cloud, with initial conditions that we prescribe for non-magnetized spherically distributed cloud of gas. We take the initial conditions actually similar to the spherical accretion, like in Bondi case derived by in the work of Bondi in 1952. But what we solve here for to set up the initial condition is the radial and density profile, radial velocity and density profile obtained by numerically solving the relativistic Bernoulli equation. So here the Bernoulli equation form is given. And the accretion onto the black hole in this solution is transonic. So we have a sonic radius denoted here by RS, where the flow reaches the speed of sound. And after it reaches the speed of sound, transonically may fall into the black hole with the speed of light. Mm-hmm. The density is set by the mass accretion rate in this way here. And what we impose on top of that is the low angular momentum profile. So we propose that the star envelope, the collapsing envelope, rotates, but with a small angular momentum. And our aim is actually to somehow constrain this amount of angular momentum, which may be adequate for the star to form a rotationally supported energetic disk or not form and disappear without forming a transient. So these are the laws that describe the specific energy and angular momentum at the innermost stable circular orbit. This is ISCO. R ISCO is the radius of this orbit. And then we have finally the profile of the angular velocity here. UFI is given by this law with the energy and angular momentum at the ISCO. Furthermore, multiplied by the sinus squared theta, because we want to have the highest rotation at the theta equal 90 degrees, which is the equatorial plane, and multiplied again by some arbitrary factor C, call it C here, where if C is zero, here on the left-hand side panel, if C is zero, we have just purely spherical accretion, no rotation. If C increasing, then we have more and more rotation. And here you see how the internal energy density is concentrated in the equatorial plane when we increase the amount of rotation, the amount of angular momentum inside this collapsing envelope. Here C goes between 0.7, 0.9, and 2 is the largest value which we have. And we see here how the bubble, rotationally supported bubble of the excess energy format when C is larger than 1 or actually 1.5 here. So it is called a supercritical rotation. The arrows here represent the velocity vectors of the flow, and the cyan line shows the location of this ISCO radius. Okay, so we wanted to determine the critical rotation of the envelope. And actually, my student, yes, Ariadna Murguia-Bertier, computed all these models. She computed a sequence of models with different normalizations of the angular momentum and was able to see how the bubble of the pressure-supported mini disk structure grows when we add more and more rotation to this flow. So here you see this bubble growth for C equals 0.9. It's actually no bubble formed. For C equal 1.2, there is bubble growing in time. Yes, the panels show the different time snapshots. So we concluded that above this critical specific angular momentum, C equal 1.2, accretion onto black hole can generate feedback because the energy content in this accretion mini disk is sufficient to produce energetic feedback and halt the collapse. An additional accumulation of the energy will result in the disruption of the entire star with a bright transient from the expanding Coulet envelope. So actually, in other words, we could produce energetic transient, energetic gamma ray burst if the rotation is higher than this critical value. But on the other hand, if the feedback is not so effective and the star is rotating not so fast, it will not produce any bright transient in our scenario, and only the star's outermost material has enough specific angular momentum to balance this critical rotation, because the rotation of the star here, omega times r square, yes, r square is the total radius of the star, would need to balance this critical C times L ISCO. L ISCO, L feedback is a function of the radius. So we found here, this plot shows that our critical value of C is again 1.2. What was done somehow support these findings or to compare these findings with the observations. First of all, we refer again to our two famous stars, these disappearing stars denoted here in the left panel with PHL and N69 something numbers. The left panel shows the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram of the stellar evolutionary models. So you see here the sequence of stellar evolution models, the evolving stars after the main sequence. The star masses on the main sequence were chosen between 15 and 40. And then here another sequence shows even more massive stars between 80 and 120 solar masses. And the dotted lines differ from the straight lines with the metallicity of the star. So here the solid lines are for solar metallicity, dotted lines are for the 0.02 times solar metallicity. And on the right panel and in the middle panel, we see how these stars compare with our simulation models. So omega versus omega break, the rotation of the star was inferred from the stellar evolution models and compared with our constraints that are given here with these teal and orchid lines. And we found that these two disappearing stars actually might fit to our constraints. If their rotation was smaller than the critical one, actually the masses of these stars and their metallicities are in the range of the stellar evolutionary models, and they could disappear without a trace. What we found more is shown on the right panel of this plot. This is a sample of stars of O type. For these stars noted by the data points, we know their rotation velocities from some observations, and we can have estimates of their masses. The masses estimates you see have quite large error bars, but still at least some of these stars are in our domain, yes, for slowly rotating massive stars, which would, in our scenario, produce no visible bright transient because of too slow rotation of their envelopes. So we found that at least about 5% of the stars, of these O-type stars known in the literature, are rotating below the critical value, and hence probably these stars are also candidates for the future disappearing stars. So these are some comments which are probably skipped for now. I just want to give the credit for the work of Ariadna Murguja, yes, who is the author of this article. She's the first author, and she started this project with me back in 2017 during the CAVI summer program on astrophysics in Copenhagen. And it took us quite a long time to complete the work because it is quite complicated, and also because of different things that happened in our lives, moving from one place to another, and also changing jobs. But I'm really happy with this paper, and it turned from the small group of two or three or four people during the school, it ended with a full ACHEI letters paper published this year with 7 co-authors. And also Ariadna was awarded the postdoctoral position via the NASA Einstein Fellowship in this year. Just 1 week ago, she sent me the email that she got the Einstein Fellowship, and she will have a free choice of the place of the university in the United States to start her first postdoctoral fellowship. So this is the project actually completed. Now about shortly, only very briefly, about two other projects that are semi-completed but not published yet. They are in the referring process. So one project actually that we started with another student about collapsars is how the mass and spin of the black hole changes during the process of collapse, because in the work with Ariadna, we didn't consider the change of mass and spin of the black hole during the collapse. We only considered the rotation of the envelope, and we considered only a small size of this envelope and small time scale for each for which it rotates, so that no angular momentum and no mass was transferred to the black hole during the simulation. It is a simplification, of course, because physically speaking, in this process, the black hole gains a lot of mass and also gains a lot of angular momentum that falls down below the horizon. So if we start with the initial mass of the black hole, the currently computed mass during the simulation will be higher and higher. And also we can compute this mass evolution, and we can also compute the spin evolution through the update of the angular momentum of the black hole with the RFI component of the stress energy tensor that is falling through the horizon of the black hole during our simulation. We also update the Kerr metric. We update the six relevant coefficients of the Gmu nu metric in the Kerr shield form. And these six coefficients will now depend on not on M, but on 1 plus delta M shown in the previous slide. So this method was developed in 2018 with Ishika Palit and Petra Sukova, and we published this method paper 2 years ago. And last year, actually, I gave the topic to the master's student who did very well with this project, and she computed black hole evolution during the collapse for several types of initial conditions, for several values of the initial spin of the black hole. So she considered not only non-rotating, but also slowly rotating black holes. And here in the right panel, you see the evolution of the spin of the black hole during the collapse. You see how much spin can increase if the rotation of the envelope is larger and larger. Yes, so small rotation of the envelope is plotted with the purple line, then the green line plots the moderate rotation of the envelope, the moderate or critical one, which gives at some moment the maximally rotating black hole. Then the black hole spins down again because of the material, which was rotating very fast, is already accreted. So only a little bit of slowly rotating material is available, and the black hole spins down. But you see the final spin here is larger than the initial one. So that we have net spin up of the black hole at the end of the collapse that we computed. And even more net spin up is possible if we have a larger rotation of the envelope. Dominika probed a range of angular momentum contents in the collapsar and a range of initial black hole spins. And she probed all the parameter space that we can have for these two parameters. She found that the growth of the black hole mass is largest when the envelope rotation is slow, and the black hole is at least moderately spinning at the initial time. Yes, so this is also important constraint. She also found some shocks propagating in the envelope and computed their velocities. The shocks are actually important to also give some energetic feedback to the envelope. So we compared her results with the findings of Ariadna, and they were a little bit different from each other. But Ariadna was studying non-spinning black holes only, and again, I should stress that she studied the non-evolving black hole, without considering the evolution of the black hole mass and spin. Finally, Dominika considered the effect of the magnetic fields on the black hole growth, and probably you don't remember how the previous figures looked, but what she found is that the spin, the final spin of the black hole in case of magnetized collapsar is a little bit less than the final spin of the black hole in case of non-magnetized collapsar. This is subject, of course, to our initial setup, initial conditions, and probably we need to investigate more types of configurations of the magnetic field in this work or in the next work. These are some snapshots from the simulation. of the collapsar model with initial black hole spin 0.5 and critical rotation. You see here on the left panel the magnetic field structure, and you see the torus, yes, or mini disk, so to speak, formed at the equatorial plane. This is its density profile. And you see a polar region, which actually is not not very low, then it's high density. Yes, again, there is high density in this panel. There are open lines of magnetic field format, but the density is not evacuated. So we are actually concluding that this type of simulation was still not able to produce the jet breakout of the envelope. Either we would need to conduct the simulation for longer time or actually do the 3D model to see how it works. And the results were published, they will be published in the abstract paper this year. We are now answering the second referee report, and we are close to acceptance of this paper. And first of all, this was the content of the master thesis by Dominika Król, defended with honors at the Jagiellonian University in July 2020, which is really a big achievement because, as far as I know, it was the only master thesis in astronomy prepared and defended on time during the pandemic year. So really big congratulations to Dominika for her efforts and not giving up in this difficult time. We have some plans for future work, for instance, consider better type of initial conditions instead of the Bondi flow, the very simple description of the initial flow, but something more advanced, more like results from the state-of-the-art stellar evolutionary models. Okay, I think I have to finish. I don't hear anybody. I don't see chat. I had one more.
Can you hear me, Agnieszka?
Work to describe, but I don't see.
Agnieszka, can you hear me?
I don't hear Maciek. should I finish? Knock. Yes. Yeah. Oh, maybe now I can hear something.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I hear you now.
Okay. As we had a delay, you could still maybe talk for 5 more minutes if you want. There is no problem because we started 20 to 1. So
okay, but it was my fault. So if you want me to stop, I can stop now. If not, I can continue with few more slides.
Well, in my opinion, you can continue. If somebody needs to leave, they will just leave. We cannot do anything about it.
Okay, so I will. Thank you. I mean, this is the third project that we have is about the jets. Yes. So again, the collapsing star or whatever is successful now to produce a bright transient event and the gamma ray burst. So we already have this central engine. We have the black hole inside this engine. We have an accreting torus. We somehow break through the envelope or get rid of this envelope of the star with some help of the winds or of the companion star or both. And we produce very fast, very energetic jet that is able to break through this envelope. And what we want to study is this jet now. Yes, so the jet problem was studied together with Kostas Sapontsis, who worked here in CFT back a few years ago. And we considered the jet energetics and variability at the base, yes, because what we can do with our simulation code is still the base of the jet. So something like up to a few hundred, few thousand at most gravitational radii from the black hole. You see here in this plot the structure of density, energetics, total energetics defined like this, so magnetization plus the thermal energy, pointing plus thermal energy, the magnetization and the jet Lorentz factor in one snapshot at evolved time. Yes, this is evolved time after we launched this jet. And what you see here these two figures, the first and the third one, are actually mirroring each other, because at the equatorial plane you have very high density torus, while the polar regions here are clean. We have no contamination from an envelope, because we just had the initial conditions satisfying this. But we have kept this clean funnel, yes, but it is highly magnetized. So sigma, the magnetization is largest at the polar regions in the jets. Then the total energetics here, described by this mu. So the sum of the pointing and thermal energy is large, but larger at the edge of the jet than in the axis, first of all. And secondly, it is variable. I decided not to show you any movies, because it would be a mess, probably even more. But you can even see on the snapshot, yes, that there is expanding blobs of the energy in this jet, expanding outwards in time. And all this energy eventually at the large distances, yes, so as you see from the engine, it has to go like about 10 to 12, 10 to 13, 14 centimeters to be able to produce these gamma rays that we observe. So all this energy, total energy, will be eventually transformed to the bulk kinetic energy of this jet, so the bulk Lorentz factor, and then eventually to radiation, gamma ray radiation through some different radiative processes like synchrotron or synchrotron self-compton. What we can probe here at the base is the variability of the magnetization and of the total energetics in the jet. And we argue that it will somehow translate into the variability observed in the emission of radiation and to our observables. So we probe the variability, we computed the minimum variability timescales of our series of models. This was done by Best in James this year, and he computed a series of models with different initial gas to magnetic pressure ratio in the accretion disk, and with also different spin of the black hole, as you met as the parameter. As you see here, we start our spin parameter family from actually quite large spin, so at least 0.6 up to 0.99, what we study, because it is known that the fast jets and the efficient gamma ray bursts require very large acceleration through the rapidly spinning black holes. What Bestin found is the correlation between the Lorentz factor in the jet and the black hole spin. Different lines here show our different models, and also they show different points in the jet where we measure this Lorentz factor, but the correlation is clear. And there is also anti-correlation between the minimum variability timescale and the black hole spin. So it is actually corresponding to observations. The observations confirm, require such behavior. So we think our model is reasonable, at least. What we also see is the relation between the Lorentz factor in the jet and the slope of the fitted power density spectrum, because this variability is actually on many timescales. Yes, so we have the PDS, power density spectrum of the variability, described best as the power law. And the slope of this power law is determined from our model. It is marked here. And also the Lorentz factor is determined from our model. So we find some relation. I cannot say it is a very, very tight correlation, but there is some relation between the Lorentz factor and the jet in the jet and this alpha slope of the power law. And this was done by Ishika Palit for this work. So the takeout message is that the detected gamma ray flux exhibits a large variety of patterns. They reflect complicated processes governing the high energy radiation, which we do not cover in our simulations. What we cover is just the base of the jet and the energetics of this jet. But the flux varies on multiple timescales, and power spectral density of the light curves can be actually inferred also from our modeling. This is frequently fitted also by observers with the power law function. They find these power law indices in a broad range. Actually, now I don't remember what are the values, but larger than one. We speculate that the relation between gamma and variability timescale that spans 10 orders of magnitude in the observations can also reach the blazar sample. Blazars are different type of objects because they are not transient, they are persistent source on the sky, and they contain supermassive black holes. So blazars are somehow analogs of the GRBs, but in a larger mass scale and in the larger time scale of the operation of such an engine. But they share some similarities in the physics of this process. The smaller values of the Lorentz factor that are typically found in the blazars should be related mainly with the smaller black hole spin. So these were our conclusions from the last work. This is just submitted to Astrophysical Journal. And thank you for your attention, and thank you for your patience.
Thank you very much. So
can you make it so that I hear something?
Yes. So can you hear us, Agnieszka, now?
Yes, I hear.
Okay. Do we have any questions? Please feel free. We can still, I think, spare a couple of minutes because of the delay.
Actually, I have a question. What is your opinion about the perspective to test fundamental theories in the extreme environment of black holes and gamma ray bursts emerging from black holes?
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe I didn't mention one thing, but it's no time for that. The very structure of this accretion disk, if we forget about this simple equation of state, actually is very sensitive to fundamental physics, yes, because the structure of this disk results from what is inside the star, or either in the massive star core, or in case of mergers of neutron stars, what is the equation of state of the neutronized matter. So there is a large number of possibilities to study the fundamental physics with this. Yes, the equation of state of the dense matter, the neutrino emission, and the question of oscillations of neutrinos, also like how they affect the process of nuclear fusion. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. I see the question. I have a question.
Bożena.
Okay. Very nice results. I have a question to the first part. This collapser. I think in observations sometimes we see very long gamma ray bursts, like more than 1 hour, something like that. Do you see any possibility to model that within the collapsar scenario? Maybe I didn't catch the plot.
Which plot? Probably this one.
Yes, so normally
observational data here from BATS, Swift, and Fermi, mm-hmm. and you are right. Some points are about 1,000 seconds. Mm-hmm. T90 of the jet. T90 is the time when the 90% of the gamma rays reach the tech pole. So yes, it is 1,000 mm-hmm. seconds. And this is observed duration, as the author Spiran describes in his review. And this is the time difference between central engine and the jet breakout time. So one thing is also the process of the jet breakout how long it takes for the jet, depending on energy of this jet, to break through the envelope.
And then your models can reach such long time scales?
No, my models cannot reach such long time scales because my models operate on time of a few seconds. Yes, this range. Definitely my model is not able to reach these time scales. But it doesn't mean that they are not produced by collapsars. It's just the limitation, the technical limitation of the size of the grid and time of the computation.
You think that you don't need extra magnetic field or extra something else, it's just a matter of extending computations?
Oh no, that is also true, what you say about extra magnetic field or whatever manipulations with the magnetic field structure or bringing the magnetic field, the magnetic flux, yes, from outside, supporting the magnetic field, it is important. Yes, and in this simple model, we don't have such possibility. We would need to take it from somewhere else.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, do we have any further questions? I don't see any raised hands. Okay, so if not, then I think we can thank our speaker again and finish at this time. Thank you, Agnieszka.
Thank you
very much. See you all next week.
Thank you very much.